Concorde. The name recalls a distant era when air travel was more like this.
Welcome aboard the spacious cabin.
Than this.
Oh my, I want help! This guy's crazy!
Almost two decades after the Concorde's last supersonic leap across the ocean, Concorde nostalgia suddenly seems in full swing.
All chairs will have tray tables, not just first class. I feel like I'm flying on the Concorde.
You can leave anytime.
Meanwhile, a new generation of companies is promising to bring supersonic jets back to an airport near you by as soon as the end of this decade. But can any of these companies successfully pick up where the failed Concorde left off?
So the Concorde operated in the North Atlantic. It was primarily Paris and London to New York and Washington.
And we're now supersonic. That's 11 minutes after takeoff.
It's always exciting flying supersonic, and it's always exciting to get to New York before you've left.
There was a large measure of style and panache, and it wasn't like the world's most comfortable cabin or seat compared to what you would get on a private jet today. But it was also the bragging rights of how fast you could do a day trip if you wanted.
Concorde has crossed the Atlantic in 3.5 hours. First, best, and fastest.
It just never became a product for the masses. And, you know, part of that was just the fuel cost. These engines were engineering marvels, but at the same time, just completely fuel inefficient in terms of what they had to do.
After nearly three decades in service, the Concorde was retired in 2003 due to rising costs, weakening demand for air travel after 9/11, and a dampened safety reputation following a fatal crash in 2000. Once at the bleeding edge of aviation technology, the legendary plane for the elite had become a relic, destined for museums and exhibitions. Today, whether you're paying to ride back here or up here, you'll arrive at about the same time. And that's because aircraft manufacturers and airlines have spent the past half century focusing on things like efficiency, safety, and cabin comforts, rather than raw speed. But after almost two decades since Concorde's demise, speed may be making a comeback.
There is venture capital money and investors that are willing to bet that this could work. Secondly, there's technology available today that was never, ever contemplated in the 1960s. You can model so many things with computers and the new materials, carbon composites. All those things are coming together so that you have some technically minded people saying, why shouldn't this happen?
When Concorde shut down about 20 years ago, there was really no plan to pick up where it left off. And so that's what we're doing at Boom. We're building high-speed travel that can be available to more people than ever before.
Boom is just one of a number of young companies that have snatched up the brightest aerospace engineers for the task of designing a new generation of supersonic aircraft.
Every airplane looks good on paper, but when you go from a paper design to a physical airplane that you're going to put a human life in and then go fly, you have to solve thousands of problems along the way. But it's not inventing new science, and it's not inventing new technology.
Boom has been developing an experimental supersonic jet called the XB-1, which, if successful, will be
the first independently developed supersonic jet ever.
With a name that harkens back to the original supersonic jet, the X-1, the XB-1 will be used to test and refine the engineering that will ultimately lead to a 100-seat jet called Overture. That's more like a Concorde 2.0. And if all goes well,
we'll be carrying our first passengers by the end of the decade.
But building a commercial plane that can break the sound barrier is old news at this point.
I think Google could probably go build a supersonic business jet in pretty short order if they wanted to. One, not to sell it, but just to do it. You know, it's just got to be an economical product. You can't just do it as a vanity thing.
The first commercial supersonic experiments in the 1960s were essentially that, vanity projects. The jointly built British and French jet, literally a Concorde between nations, and rival prototypes from the Soviets and the Americans were developed during the same Cold War technology race that landed humans on the moon. National prestige outweighed concerns about profitability, at least for a little while.
What about the potential market for Concorde? What's the lowest that could be sold and perhaps the highest?
If we sold 50 or less, I should be a very disappointed man.
Disappointed indeed. Though it started out with over 100 pre-orders, the jet's problematic economics quickly brought that number down to just 14, delivered to the national airlines of the countries that built it. But the next generation of supersonics are being designed mostly by private companies, where market viability isn't merely an afterthought, it's paramount.
So since Concorde retired in 2003, there's been a 2.5-fold increase in international travel. And that creates a lot more markets for supersonic. And when you put together all the new technology, aerodynamics, materials, propulsion, you can now build an aircraft that's significantly more efficient than Concorde, which means it can be available to tens of millions of people at fares kind of like what you'd pay in business class today, instead of the, you know, the 4X first class that had to be charged on Concorde.
So far, Boom's bold aspirations have already caught the attention of a handful of airlines that have placed small pre-orders for the company's Overture jet. But whether these early votes of confidence will translate into success depends on the final economics. Another eager startup taking a different approach to the new supersonic race is Spike Aerospace, which is developing the S-512, an 18-passenger aircraft targeted at the nearly $30 billion private business jet market. Like Boom, though, one of Spike's long-term goals is to eventually expand supersonic travel beyond the realm of elite luxury.
We look back to the 90s when they first had flat-screen TVs. They were $25,000 a screen. Nobody could afford it. You know, Joe Public couldn't afford it. It's only for the super rich. But now flat-screen TVs are all $200. And the same thing's going to happen in supersonic flight. Yes, initially it probably will be for business travelers and the rich folks. There is a demand, they have a need, they can afford to fly it. As we recover cost and research and development and technologies, we'll be able to offer that same supersonic flight service to the general public. I don't know that'll be as cheap as economy flights, but it'll be affordable or more affordable than it will be initially.
Before these next generation supersonics can make it to market though, there are other dark legacies of Concorde that could divert a supersonic comeback. The first is simply too loud to ignore.
What did you think about it?
Oh, it made you jump.
It made you jump,
yes,
did it? Yes. You frightened of it at all?
No, not exactly.
What did you think of it, sir?
Rather a slow one, I thought.
The deafening takeoff noise and infamous sonic booms of supersonic aircraft crossing the sound barrier were so disruptive that it led to widespread backlash and protests in the 1960s, eventually forcing governments to ban all supersonic flight over land. But there's a potential solution taking shape that could address both the physics and the regulation dilemmas of the sonic boom.
X-59 is really a culmination of decades of work by NASA to try and solve the sonic boom problem, essentially to find a way to reduce sonic booms such that it's not a boom anymore, but a sound that might be acceptable if heard every day.
To accomplish that goal, NASA has partnered with Lockheed Martin's famous Skunk Works division to develop an advanced airframe design that can actually minimize the impact of the sonic shockwave on the ground. But the heart of the project is about gauging public reaction in order to pave the way for new supersonic federal and international guidelines.
Our plan is to do essentially 5 to 6 tests in various locations in the United States. So hopefully get on the order of, you know, thousands of survey responses. You know, given a sound of a certain level, this percentage of the population is annoyed. So it's all about providing data that can help the FAA and the ICAO establish the limits that go along with this certification standard.
Reducing or eliminating the nuisance of sonic booms could open up countless new routes, helping to make an economy of scale for supersonic travel that was never possible for Concorde. But there's another drawback of supersonic flight that has taken on a new importance over the past few decades: fuel consumption and emissions. In order to propel its 100-seat cabin to speeds of nearly 1,400 miles per hour, Concorde burned multiple times the amount of fuel per passenger versus a typical transoceanic jet. Given the fluctuating costs of fuel and the growing concern over the environmental impacts of air travel, it's hard to imagine a modern carrier purchasing planes as thirsty and messy as the Concorde once was. But recent technological strides may give the supersonic startups a chance to rectify this negative legacy as well.
Speed is not enough. We need to do it in an environmentally responsible way. And so the question really for us was, can we engineer these liquid fuels instead of just relying on fossil-based fuels that are obviously bad for our environment?
Aerion has partnered with Canada-based Carbon Engineering, whose direct air capture technology pulls CO2 right out of the air, which can then be processed into commercial products like jet fuel. It's still a bit theoretical at this point, but it would mean essentially carbon neutral high-speed flight.
So think about the only CO2 that the AS2, Aerion's airplane, puts into the atmosphere was first CO2 we took out of the air to make the fuel. So not only do we go really, really fast, but we have no footprint on the environment.
While all of these supersonic startups are eager for us to break the sound barrier again, it's hard not to be at least a little bit skeptical of the projections, given how notoriously difficult aircraft development can be. For instance, Boeing's wide-body 787 Dreamliner reportedly ran billions of dollars over budget and arrived to market 3 years later than expected. And that's for a jet based largely on proven subsonic technology and well-proven subsonic economics. There's also the unknown long-term impact on demand in a post-pandemic world, in which business or VIP travel may be replaced more often by a virtual meeting instead. Then again, supersonic might actually offer extra appeal for travelers trying to cut down on the time spent in an enclosed cabin with a bunch of other people.
The customer wants 100 things. I think that's where the rubber hits the road, or whatever the cliche is. You know, that's where you're going to see, it's like, can you, not can you build this plane, but can you do it within all these parameters that the market is setting for you?
Another way to look at the new supersonic race is that it's part of a broader vision for a future with simply more options for long-distance travel, whether by supersonic, hypersonic, or an entirely new mode like suborbital flights that hop between points on the globe. This latest round of startups are simply pushing us toward that frontier. And that might sound a little pie in the sky, but when you're trying to usher in a new age of superfast travel, it helps to be optimistic.
We're going to go across the Atlantic and come home the same day. We're going to have more meetings in person. It's going to change who you can fall in love with. You know, I want a world where no relationship is ever considered long distance. You know, that's not science fiction.